born in Wheeling, West Virginia. My father was an oil company executive who worked in Pittsburgh. Came home on the weekends and saw the Ohio River, and right outside my window, well, several blocks away, was a famous bridge that was built by 1847 by Millennium, whatever it was.
What was the bridge? What was the name of the bridge?
Well, it was just the Wheeling Suspension Bridge. At the time it was built, it was the longest bridge in the world.
In the world.
1,010 feet long. And my grandfather owned stock in a bridge, privately. There to go across it was a nickel in your automobile, one cent if you walk. And I used to lie in bed, look out the window, and count the traffic as it went across. After 20 cars would go, I'd say the old man made another buck. Boy, what a way to make a living. But it was such a landmark in my life. Walked over it many times, in fact, a couple of years ago. Walked it both ways two or three times.
Is it still a toll bridge?
No, it belongs to the state of California, the state of Washington, West Virginia now. It is doing, yeah. And, but that reminds me, I had an uncle who was mining it. Buried in Arlington, an army officer in World War II. And used to spend some time every summer with him in Ohio at his coal mine. I would work in a blacksmith shop, surveying office, where I'd go down in the mine sometime. So the little miners had light on. All those things just signed me engineering. I never really thought of doing anything else. So when I got out of the Army in 1945, I went back to Purdue.
Could we just go back a second? Would you just tell us a little bit about your elementary and high school education, you know, favorite subjects, and just a little bit about that before we go forward?
Well, I went to all the way through grade school and high school in Tulsa, Oklahoma. With my father being an oil man, we moved out to the oil capital of the world. And I guess I liked history very well because I still remember my history teacher. Mathematics, I did well at. Trouble. Latin, I remember because I learned how to translate that by looking at my mother's old Latin books and getting the things she noted down in places where they thought they were hard to translate and gave you a translation in the back. Add those all together and you had a pretty good leg up on the day's reading. But I wasn't much good at art. I did like shop. I would go to the welding shop, some casting of cast iron. I was very nice. And drafting. All of those engineering things sort of fit my.
Tell us what led you to Purdue? You talked with me earlier about how you chose Purdue, or how your father chose Purdue for you.
Yeah, well, my father hadn't been to college. But he was anxious that his sons all go to school. And so he would be out traveling in the Midwest mainly. And he would always inspect the college campus where he was.
What was it like? What was campus life like when you were there?
Well, I thought it was just brilliant, you know. After the first 2 years, I found a girlfriend there. And that was pretty hard to do because the ratio of men and women was very high. Much more about it. It was still 1941. father-in-law's had, two starting up in April or whatever it was, you better get going and see how Bill's going to run out on it. I saw the wisdom of that, so I signed up for the GI Bill and went to work on a master's degree.
What year would that have been?
That was in 1945.
Okay.
No, 46. Beginning of 46.
Okay.
And I got the master's degree in June 48. And so I studied soil mechanics and I studied bridging and all that. When I first came back as a student, I was a sophomore. And the office mate for Professor Charles A. Ellis, who had a eventually, I decided that teaching wasn't for me. I went back to work for Braun in California. And shortly after that, Professor Ellis passed away. Sometime there. And after that, I had up in the identity. Very excited phone call from John Ramsey. Oh, you got the paper there. I'm coming down tomorrow. I'll be there tomorrow. Said I had got John Ellison, got Charles Ellison's signature on it. And the other big picture that I have has got the pseudo signature on it. And everybody now, I think, except the bridge minister, is satisfied that Ellis really designed. Watching the police go. A video on CBS, or on National Public Radio about American experience. He had a very good presentation on the Golden Gate Bridge. It's constructed. Develops a lot of them, but they do admit to the design.
Okay. What was Van Der Zee's interest in the Golden Gate Bridge?
Van Der Zee was a good friend. Van Der Zee's father was a judge, a principal judge.
Was it Russ?
Russ. Yeah.
Cohn? Yeah.
Yeah, that's the paper.
Yeah.
And Russ and John Founders were very good friends. And for years, Russ's father had been the resident engineer on the bridge now. And so he knew all about what. Everybody agreed that Dallas would have more recognition than he was able to give it. So, anyhow, they kept fishing around with us and we were working on it, making proposals of the bridge district and so forth. And they never got it. Mostly it's not known why. Maybe if a bridge affects the models, I know. Maybe sewer corporation. They go through the little ones. And with these people, we worked on again on boring things and various means of stabilizing drilling rigs when they were trying to drill for oil or for the bottom. Units of a plant, we were building a plant for, I guess it was North Carolina, Puget Sound, Alaska. They're upon the idea of having these units of the plant fabricated in Japan, where we got the boats taken over there, and we could just bolt them together. Save a lot of construction time for bad weather and all. Well, that worked fine. I got assigned to study the weather on the way and what could happen to barges in that big tall chunk of the fire. Upside down, the higher he went up above the deck, the less the force was as the ship pulled back and forth. Now, that went wrong. And I tried to get the machine ready to go. So I went to the vice president, wrong. Thought he wrote a letter and said, you want us to redo your service criteria here. And the Japanese have been to see us. I told them when we talked about it, don't use it up there. Right side up. Oh, yes, we know. We just don't want to say anything about it. So, anyhow, that got. And we worked on all kinds of things. The last big thing we worked on was the refinery for the weight petroleum company over in Sweet City. Critical shortage of petroleum. We're going to reduce shale oil, shale flares. So, I figured, well, I'm almost 65, I think I'll check out here. Which I did at the end of 1984.
84.
I don't know if I need anything else.
One question I had, do you think that your father's being in the oil business had anything to do with your... I don't know when it ran out, but let's continue on. We were talking about Joseph Strauss and his role in the company.
No,
the fact that he wasn't a degreed engineer, but he did have some skill at it.
Oh, yeah.
And more ego
good
than
skill
anything.
And, mechanical bridges are kind of special in my there's a lot of them up in San Francisco area, back to Chicago area. And he was really told to go. But somehow or other, I guess he decided. Final night was to be on the whole history. Then it would be the first class, fifth structure. Well, the other engineers that worked with it, the voice guy, Paul, kind of worked with Elvis.
So he fired him?
He fired him. Took this other guy back. Decided to jump out of there. test for, the test was very satisfactory. Everybody wasn't distraught.
Some guardian angels here. What else has she got here for me to ask you? Let's see. On May 2004, PBS, WGBH Boston aired a program, Golden Gate Bridge. Were you contacted by the producers for a source on the Ellis and the bridge? You were not contacted. Oh, APSI was. Okay. Okay.
Earlier one was about APSI also.
Interesting.
But the original rubber cut was diameter.
Charlie. I don't know him, but I know of him.
Charlie was an engineer out here. And he graduated during the war, which is a couple of years after. And I was talking to Charlie one day about Charlie's house. He said, oh, yeah, I know him very well. He was in one of the bunch of people. And he went to sleep. And so and so like a business
any of his jokes?
Well, he had saying jokes.
Uh-huh.
One was, he would recommend that my idea of a good student, somebody can stay out till 3 o'clock in the morning with his girl, have a good time, come home, study till 6 o'clock, and be at his 8 o'clock class on time. That's my idea of a good student.
I can can see why he would appeal to students, you know, with that kind of a sense of humor, and just, he seemed to be in touch with the students.
He always looked like he was wearing starch collar, but I don't know whether he was or not. And his face was something to get very red.
He get embarrassed? Was he embarrassed?
Well, I don't know if he was embarrassed or what it was, but something like that. I don't know, maybe I said he wasn't smart. He'd red in the face. But he wouldn't, he wasn't angry, you know. He thought it was a good joke. Mm-hmm. And you could see that twinkle in his eye. Led you to know that he wasn't angry. That was a good one.
Yeah. Did you know that? Did you understand that about him when you were an undergraduate student, or did you?
Oh, no.
You did? Okay.
Yeah. And, he also taught us soil mechanics.
Let's see, what else do we, okay, here's another question for you, and I have just a few more.
I'll put it all out.
Okay. Ellis was a faculty member at the University of Michigan from 1908 to 1912, University of Illinois from 1914 to 1921, and Purdue 1934 to 1946. Yet, this collection contains none of his papers from these other universities. There are some copies of journal articles. Could you shed some light on the papers? Do you know where else his papers might be? So you say there are some at Cal State?
Well, everybody will have a copy of the old engineering paper.
Another question that relates to something you talked about earlier about your relationship with Ellis. I don't think that we knew before now, before you're telling us that you were, he was your office mate or you were his office mate while you were a graduate student. So you must have, first of all, was he your major professor?
Yeah.
He was your major professor.
Yeah.
Okay.
He was only there. I came back in June. Left in December.
That's right.
We had 6 months overlap.
Okay.
Lawrence, he wired.
Okay. So it started with Ellis and then you switched
yeah.
off. How did your opinion of him change after, well, I guess from being an undergraduate student to actually sharing an office with him? Would you change your view of him, or just maybe get to know him better or more personally?
Interesting question. I think I got to know him a little better, yeah. But not a whole lot. While he was very open at certain times of the day, when he was at the office with most people, he didn't sit around and chit-chat. You got the feel of it, which you didn't really be inside. Maybe that's partly my fault. I should ask him more questions, I guess.
You were on a mission, too.
Yeah, that's right. I wanted to get out of there.
Did you socialize with them while you were a graduate
student? Not really, except I might say that my father owned a farm out on Route 43 in town.
Uh-huh.
And he was the one who was in place for permaculture. Well, during the war, while I was in Burma, the team was chafing all the time under what her mother was doing. So, if I got old, number one, fly out. Yes, we did. But then they inferred, this is why Mrs. McClinton never wanted to live on the farm. That was her idea of backwater business. So, Ellis was moving back to Evanston. So she said, we'll buy Ellis back. And he did. So we moved from the farm to Ellis' house. There on Walter Street. In fact, I had Walter's furniture for a while.
Graduate student, huh?
Yeah.
Wow.
You know, we saved all this money during the war. You know, I was an officer. Mm-hmm. Very good money.
Yeah.
Seeing the Scotch and their spending, so.
Uh-huh.
Did not really.
Did you have your children by that time?
We have one. Lewis.
How old was he when you came back then?
About 2 and 3.
That was the first time you saw him.
Oh, I got deluged with photographs.
Oh, okay.
Which you can see if you want to. Got a little home from Burma. In the same old frame I had before.
No, really? Well, is there anything else that you'd like to tell us about Ellis?
Probably, but I can't remember.
This has been a long, excellent session.
Well, I'm understanding.
Well, well, really appreciate it, and I'll tell you, I'll re-ask the question. How did you finally decide to get the papers to Purdue University?
Oh, well, that wasn't hard at all, because of my connection with the Institute of Education at Purdue. It's just kind of natural if I'm going to get away. And I found out what the Bridge District was like. They gave Ellis a job when he needed one.
Okay.